Hello, everybody. It's Larry Kotlikoff back with Economics Matters, the podcast. I'm delighted to have Kerry Hector with me today. Kerry is the founder and editor of Retirement Income Journal. It's an independent online publication providing news coverage and analysis of the global retirement industry. And it goes out to thousands of professionals working in life insurance, 401k, that industry. So we're talking about mutual fund money managers and people running mutual fund companies, asset managers in banks and all kinds of financial institutions, advisory firms, brokers, insurance agencies, marketing organizations, actuarial firms, financial trade associations, law firms, academia. So he has a big following. He's got quite the career here. He's the author of a famous book called Annuities for Dummies. It was published in 2008 by Wiley. The most recent edition just came out last year. So Annuities for Dummies, if you're interested in annuities, anything about them, this is like the Bible. And you need to take a look at this book. It's available everywhere, Annuities for Dummies. Now, just a couple other words, and then we're going to turn over to Kerry to fill in the dots here, because he didn't suddenly materialize, go from birth to being the founder of this very important journal just overnight. Okay, so there was a path. So Kerry worked for 9 years as an editor in the retirement division of Vanguard, and then he later served as senior editor at Annuity Market News in New York. He's looked at the retirement systems as an on-site consultant in Costa Rica, Spain, Israel, Iceland, and France. So he has this real international perspective, a very in-depth perspective. He's received National Press Foundation fellowships twice, 2009, 2010. And he has published feature articles in the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, the Los Angeles Times, and other national publications. And for 3 years, he was a reporter at the Billings Gazette in Billings, Montana. He graduated from Kenyon College. We just realized that he almost went to Penn. We were almost classmates because we're exactly the same age, I guess, right?
Very close.
Yeah. So welcome, Kerry. Thank you so much for coming on and speaking with us. Why don't you start us off by filling in, where you're born and how you chose Kenyon, and after Kenyon, what did you choose to do, and how you ended up in this particular field?
Well, it's quite a long arc. I was always going to be a journalist because I had a uncle, or rather a first cousin once removed, named by the name of Martin Mayer. And Martin Mayer wrote many books about economics in the starting in the 50s with a book called Wall Street Men and Money. And then he became known as the great explainer. He explained the legal system, he explained the banking system, he explained the fate of the dollar. He wrote many books over the years and was kind of my, wasn't actually my mentor, but he was kind of my beacon. And so I always leaned in that direction. And then I was a at I went out to school. I wanted to go to a small liberal arts school in when I graduated from high school. And so I went out to this tiny little place in Ohio where I met a lot of wonderful people and was in a wonderful kind of community and by a small community environment. I liked being in a rural place, and there I started working on the local on our school newspaper. And one of the editors on the school newspaper while I was there was Matthew Winkler, and that name should sound familiar because he was the executive editor of Bloomberg for a long time,
Right.
and we had a couple of other people who were going into journalism. And so I came out of there and went to work on the local small town newspaper, the Mount Vernon News. And then I went to Indiana University for a while and worked on the big daily there. And then I went to Montana and worked on the daily there. And it was there, I was there in about 19, at about the point where everything in journalism became business journalism. And business was where all the work was, and so I became a business journalist. And as a I did some business writing at a actually a health company called Rodale Press, and where I wrote about corporate cost containment, healthcare cost containment, which was a big deal in the early 80s. And then went on to freelance for some business magazines in New York and got interested. And I sort of rode different waves of business reporting. One was the big export boom, and there was a people somebody in Westchester started a magazine called Northeast International Business, later called International Business. So I became exposed to international business, and then I went to Vanguard in Malvern, Pennsylvania, which was a commute for me from there. And that's where I learned the retirement industry. And while I was there, learning about everything from I was writing their annuity literature and their forms, and really learning about this, and even like documenting checks as they came in, because everybody at Vanguard had to do a little of everything. And I got a real education in the mutual fund business and the financial industry in general. And then while I was there, things started to happen in the moves. Money started to move around the world. I wasn't really aware of that, but I had taken up writing for the Vanguard in-house newspaper so that I could just float all over the company and interview people from different departments and executives and find out more about what the heck was going on. And so one day I'm interviewing somebody in a department, and she's about to fly to France, and I say, "What's going on? What's going on?" She said, "Haven't you heard, you know, like there's trillions of dollars of baby boomer savings flying around the world right now, and Vanguard, you know, is about to get France's a tenth of France's retirement system in their bond funds."
Well.
So they said, "Wait, but I'm sorry, I've got to go to France now." And then other people were going to Australia, and everybody was talking about this global retirement thing. So I thought, well, I need to write about that. So I left Vanguard and then went to Annuity Market News in New York. And then when that during the financial crisis, that failed, or rather, it was just like tossed in the dumpster by the publisher, and I fished it out of the dumpster and renamed it Retirement Income Journal. And I just happened to have the entire mailing list on my own computer, so I was in business.
Well, so I think, you know, one of the messages we're getting from interviewing so many people, I think this is like the 78th or so podcast I've done since I started this, and is that people find their way on an opportunistic basis. They take advantage. They're thinking out, you know, I'm doing this, but could I leverage what I've got going or what I know, what I've just been taught into something else? And you're a perfect example of realizing that, hey, something's going out on outside of Phil, you know, what is it, Valley Forge, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, where the Vanguard is. Let's go find out about that. But then also, you know, when you pull out, you say this is a very valuable mailing list, and I can start a journal, and now you have a very big readership, followership of that. That's fantastic. So congratulations on a really cool career. So let me ask you my big question here, which is, since you're you know, founding, publishing, editing the Retirement Income Journal, what's your view about the state of retirement income? We have the largest number of baby boomers this year, well, the largest number of people in the US to retire in a given year is this year. This is peak retirement year. And I think it's like 4 million or so people retiring. That's probably 12,000 a day or something. And are they prepared in your view? Have they been, saving enough? Have they been, thoughtful in getting from their work life to the retirement life? Are they retiring too early, or have they retired at the right age? What's your kind of overall picture of retirement income at this point?
Well, I'll generalize by saying that it's impossible to generalize about this situation. And so, but there are a number of things that I think cloud everyone's point of view about this. The one thing that has always struck me in discussions about Social Security is that, well, poor people don't have to worry about retirement because Social Security is so progressive that it covers all of their living expenses. Well, I don't think that's true. I don't think Social Security is quite as progressive as some of the blah, the rather glib statements about it. So there will be a lot of people who, if they have only Social Security, they will not have a lot to live on. At the same time, when I have traveled around the world and I talk to people about our 401k plan, they think that 401k is just like this uniform thing that everybody in America has, and they're very surprised to find out that well, it's the every 401k plan is different. It depends entirely on where you work. And so you have to, and the best companies, the most profitable companies, have the best 401k plans. So if you are competitive in life and you target, I mean, both my and my siblings, targeted companies where the retirement benefits would be good. And like for instance, some people are forced. My wife and I both worked. She was in TIAA and I was at Vanguard. And both of those companies had, in addition to matches, had large voluntary contributions of like 10% a year of your pay to your 401k or 403b in the case of TIAA. So, but we had to work very hard to find those jobs. And to find those and purposely sought out those companies. And my brother went into the pharmaceutical industry because he could get a pension and a 401k at the same company. But we had to work very hard and also be very fortunate in order to get those jobs. So I guess what this bo is boiling at down to is that there's a tremendous amount of luck in the US retirement system, and that when you realize just how much luck there is, then you're not at all surprised by the great divergence in the level of retirement security that Americans
Yeah,
will
I think
have.
I read the other day that only 10% of low-income workers are actually in have access to retirement account plans, and then a large fraction of people that do have access are not contributing enough, or maybe anything at all. We now have companies who are kind of, when you join up, who do the companies that do have 401k plans or 403b plans for the nonprofits. Now they were saying, well, you're automatically enrolled, you're defaulted into the system, and if you want to opt out of it, you can do that. But the default is that you're enrolled. It used to be the other way around, and I think there is some evidence that switching the default to be in rather than out has kept people in. That people are kind of get stuck. They don't like to do things. Say if I'm
Now, the biggest hole in the data for me has been, and maybe I just haven't looked hard enough, is when I get the data on, and in fact, today there was an Aspen Institute Morningstar webcast on their study of the gender and racial breakdowns in 401k balances. But I've never been able to find studies that show both spouses' savings in the same. It's always the all the 401k studies have the individuals. And so I'm thinking, well, these numbers don't mean much to me unless we're talking about household savings. And so that's always so we have another I say that because we have another confusion or confounding factor in understanding retirement security in that we don't know how many times that there are couples that both have the same amount, say, of 401k savings, and that they're retiring on both of them and on two Social Security. I do know from my work, from looking at this, is that people who have two Social Security systems,
Checks,
pay
yeah,
checks
checks.
and two defined contribution plans and a house are not going to are do not end up poor in retirement or destitute or anything. And then, but that's saying a lot. I mean, and then the question is, well, how many people in the United States are in that situation? I think that would, I don't really know, but I would the Vanguard used to estimate that there's 30% people will of 30% of the people will be okay in retirement. 30% of the people, about another third will struggle and make it, and about 30% are going to be in deep trouble. That was Steve Utkus from Vanguard used to say that. He's retired now. I don't know whether he's changed his mind, but that was the the scenario that I was educated in.
Now, the ones, even if you're in a good plan, you could still be at risk because you could, maybe your plan has a stock fund. Maybe it's an index fund stock fund. It's low cost, perhaps an index bond fund. You could still get nervous when stocks tank and sell at the bottom, and then turn around and buy at the top, and end up dissipating your contributions through time because you just had bad luck and or you had bad advice. And then in retirement, when you start taking withdrawals, you may annuitize them, buy an annuity. Maybe it's a single life or a joint spousal annuity. And the annuities that are now being offered are, and the majority that have been offered forever, are nominal annuities. They're not protected against inflation. If inflation is 30% this year, your annuity payment is not going to go up 30%. It's not going to go up at all. What's going to happen is that your purchasing power of that annuity is going to drop 30%. Having just seen significant inflation cumulatively, maybe 15, 20% since over the last 3 or 4 years. This means that people that retired, let's say right around COVID, and bought an annuity thinking that would keep them getting a steady stream of income till the end of their days, they just lost in purchasing power terms, maybe 20% of that purchasing power. So maybe you struggled your whole life to contribute, to invest what you think's wisely, not to panic, and then at the end you say, well, I could live to 100, so I'm going to protect myself against longevity risk, and then you get zapped by this inflation risk. That to me is like getting killed at the very end. It's like the end of a Coen Brothers movie.
Yeah. Well, here, let me clarify something here, though. There's a very common misconception about annuities. What the products that are called annuity, there are many, many products, let's say maybe eight, six or eight major products, that financial products that are called annuities. And they are more alike than they are. They are more different than they are alike. In fact, it's a they are meant for different people at different times of their lives, and they're regulated in different ways, and they have different kinds of salespeople, and some are based on underlying investments that are mutual funds, others on bonds, others on options. the as soon as when I read in the press, as soon as I hear somebody talk about annuities in general, I know that we're off the rails. Because now the particular kind of annuity that you are talking about here is the least used annuity.
That's
So
a single annuity.
it's not worth us spending a whole lot of time on because almost nobody buys this. And I don't want to go down the rabbit hole of, I mean, we can talk about how you can solve the inflation problem by saying like buying a ladder of them or something, but there's no use to going down that road because we're talking about a very small population of people who think they're going to live a very long time and who are going to more than break even on that product simply because they're going to live so much longer than average. But hardly anyone buys that product. Most of what is sold as an annuity today, especially today with high interest rates, is fixed deferred annuities. There are two kinds. One is the fixed rate annuity, which sells mainly, largely at banks, also through agents, and which is a terrific deal right now because you can put your money away for 10 years and 5 years or 7 years, but mostly for 3 to 5 years, so I think for the fixed rate, and get a much better than a CD rate. So if you're in the market for CDs, a fixed rate annuity, a fixed rate multi-year guaranteed rate annuity is better than a CD. And it's not an annuity. It's called an annuity because there's a clause inside the contract that says you can annuitize it anytime you want to and turn it into an income. That's the only thing that makes it an annuity.
It's like
It's
a bond.
really a bond. So, and then the other big seller this year, not as great so far as the fixed rate, because the fixed rate is kind of a no-brainer for people who are in this CD category market. The fixed indexed annuity is the one that is the darling of the insurance industry right now, and it is the one that is the center of all the controversy.
And this is where your money's invested in the market, but you're given a guarantee.
No, 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 no. No, that's where, no, the fixed indexed annuity is, let's say when you buy a fixed rate annuity, the company says, okay, we'll pay you 4% a year for the next 3 years, guaranteed, or 4.5% or whatever. And the fixed indexed annuity says, okay, we're going to take that 4.5%. Now tell me if I'm getting too arcane, but I'll just make this very brief. Okay, so you have a fixed rate annuity, you get a guaranteed 4.5% for 3 or 5 years. Fixed indexed annuity, they take that 4.5% and they go to the options market and they buy options on an equity index or a hybrid index or a newfangled index that somebody just created. And they buy 4.5% of your principal, of they use your yield to buy options on the market. And then if the stock market goes up, if the index goes up, you gain. And the idea is, but if it goes down, you don't lose anything because the options expire without value and you're made whole by the growth of the underlying fund. It's not, but this product is one of the most important products to the entire annuity industry, the life insurance industry. And that's the one that the Department of Labor is making so much fuss about. And it's the one that the insurance agents are so eager to keep regulations low on because it's their bread and butter.
Okay,
And
let's talk about the DOL, the Department of Labor's
okay, we'll get
emphasis.
away from the options market and talk about regulation.
So I understand, this is the most common annuity you're saying is the one where you basically your principal is guaranteed, but then you have options. In effect, you're investing in options and you have some upside, but the worst could be that you just get your money back. Over 3 or 5 years, you just get back what you put in, and your options didn't do well. The market really tanked.
Well, no, we're mixing those up a little. The fixed rate annuity is just has a guaranteed rate of return.
No, I didn't
The
mean the fixed rate. I meant the indexed annuity.
oh yeah, the indexed, you take the get the you say, okay, instead of taking 4.5%, I'll use that five per, in cash, I'll take use that 4.5% to buy options, and maybe I can do better than 4.5%.
Got it. So yesterday in the New York Times, there was this big article, which I had trouble really understanding. It's about the Department of Labor issuing new regulations, which have been now discussed in the financial industry with the financial industry, with Wall Street, and there's been lots written about it. But it would make those who sell these products we're talking about, particularly the indexed annuity you're referring to, it would put them into a position of being fiduciaries, as I understand it. And maybe you can then tell us what that means and what the situation currently is, what the new situation would be, and why the insurance industry is so up in arms. Because I take it that these products you're talking about are insurance industry products. They're not products you're going to get from let's say from Vanguard. They're not mutual fund products.
Yes, these are products that a person with an insurance license can sell, needs no other kind of training or license to sell. So if you're an insurance agent, you can make 7, 8% on an annuity sale by selling one of these fixed indexed annuities. You simply have to be an insurance agent. You don't have to be an expert in retirement income planning, and it's the bread and butter. That's they're able to sell. Ordinary insurance agents can go out and sell these products to people to use the money in their IRAs to buy the product and pay them a very high commission, and these products have sold increasingly well over the years.
So
And the
7%'s a huge commission. I mean, you're saying that I buy like a in effect a 5-year indexed annuity, the type you're describing, for I s spend $1 million on it, I immediately am losing out $70,000 for having just made the transaction. Is that what we're saying here? You said 7%.
well
That's a very high commission to me.
Well, that is exactly why the argument with the DOL is so contentious, because the DOL is threatening that livelihood. And they are and through a very and but from the consumer's point that you could so from the agent's point of view, you are taking his money off his ta you're taking food off his family's table, and you are suddenly forcing him to work to be a doctor instead of, a medic, or to it's like making an EMT guy buy, it's like they're asking an EMT guy to buy an obstetrician's level of malpractice insurance. And they're saying, oh my God, you're going to kill the EMT business. We can't go out and just help people anymore and give them this, because you're saying that we now have to buy all this malpractice insurance, or we can't do that. And they say, you're out of your mind. We're not doctors. Well, the DOL says, well, if you're not a doctor, you can't operate on them. And they say, well, what we're doing is not really operating. But they're saying, well, sometimes we do operate, or we have this other hat and we can put that on and we can operate when we're wearing that hat. And the DOL says, no, wait, the person, the client, when they're there and they're, waiting for the defibrillator to arrive, And they don't care whether the person who saves their life has malpractice insurance.
Right.
They just want to know, are you committed to saving my life? And do you know how to do it? And are you going to treat me fairly? Or, I don't know if that's a good analogy, but that's what they're saying. They're saying you're going to kill the EMT business, you're going to kill the insurance agent
Because
business.
these agents would have to buy insurance against being sued. Is that what you're saying?
Well, no, that's the analogy part. They would suddenly be the DOL tried in 2016 make them liable to class action lawsuits, for instance. The DOL will have, under any circumstances, the DOL will have a hard time enforcing this. Let me back up a little and get out of the weeds a bit to tell people that the way that financial services and financial products is regulated in the United States is incredibly fragmented, overlapping, confused. We're the only country in the world that regulates insurance at the local level and securities at the national level. And as the insurance and the investment business has come to be so intertwined, to have these two separate regulatory regimes, it makes less and less sense. And the DOL, and so various regulators are asserting themselves, and various, constituencies like industries, which have vested interests in some of these things, are all fighting over who rules what turf. And that's what this is.
So if you're I'm a client of yours, you're trying to market, you're an ins working for an insurance company, at least maybe you have several different hats, you've got different certifications. So maybe with one of these certifications you're eligible to sell me this indexed annuity, which is basically a bond where the return is used to buy options. For it, but you're going to charge me 7% possibly for the privilege. And the issue here is whether I'm well informed about that you're taking 7% of my money right off the top or not. I mean, a fiduciary would have a responsibility to anybody I think who's honest would have a responsibility to explain this, because I personally could go off and buy options on my own. And also, I could buy a bond and take the interest every year or every 6 months if it's a treasury bond, maybe it's an inflation index bond, take income and use it and buy options and see how I do and not pay the 7% commission. So from your perspective, you haven't, let's say you haven't been telling me this. Would you now be obligated to tell me about the 7% commission? Have you been like hiding this information from me? If you've been honest and truthful, why would you care that you would now be designated a fiduciary? What's your current designation in terms of the regulation? And now you're going to be called a fiduciary. How does that change in your kind of government designation change your behavior or require you to change your behavior?
Well, the insurance agents can't. Well, here's how it might play out. Let's say there's a situation where I'm licensed to sell you securities and I'm licensed to sell you insurance. And so I could, and if I come to you and I try to maximize the returns for myself instead of you, I can be in trouble. And that makes perfect sense, right? Really, it's unfortunate that you can't trust the person that's giving you advice. And the reason you can't trust that person, because that person is usually just an employee. That person is not a wise man or woman who's dealing in wisdom about the finances. That person is trying to put food on their own table, and And but where it gets messy is that when a guy with lots of licenses comes and says, "Okay, I'm going to take $500,000 and I'm going to put it in mutual funds for you, and I'm going to charge 1% a year, and then I'm going to put other 500,000 in a indexed annuity, and I'm with a lifetime guarantee, and I'm going to charge you $35,000. You know, I'm going to get a $35,000 commission today, you know, for doing that." And the DOL doesn't think that that should be at all, that that's not transparent now, and they simply want that to be all transparent. The other argument, I mean, I talked to many insurance people about this. Their argument is that we go out to a farmhouse or whatever, and people are there and they don't know what to do about the retirement. And we go and we say, "Listen, don't worry. Put your money in this annuity. You'll get 500 a month for the rest of your life, and you can't lose any money on it. And it's better than you sitting here and quaking and keeping all your money in a money market." And that's the way they said, "We spread good in the world. And you are going to try to ruin the good by making it the best. And it's not the best. We know that. We work down there in the trenches with people who know nothing about money. And listen, it's
So
better than."
we deserve the 35K because we're psychologists. Partly, we went and convinced these people to get into the market in some level or whatever, rather than just sit on their cash.
What it all comes down to is there, it's more complicated than that, but what it comes down to, the reason this is blood in the streets is over that commission.
And do you, I mean, has this become law at this point? I mean, has the government actually passed this reg, the DOL, that they approved this reg?
It ain't over till it's over.
Okay.
It's like in 2016, they passed it. And then the administration changed and it was reversed. So they've been working on this for a decade or more. The government started trying to regulate fixed indexed annuities in 2007 when the SEC went after them. And they haven't been able to catch them yet. So,
But to be clear, this is going to be, if they do pass this reg, approve this reg, which I think is imminent from what the New York Times suggested, that maybe within a couple of weeks they're going to say this is the rule of the land as long as at least Biden is president, which might be another 4.5 years. And therefore, if you sell this product as an insurance agent, you are now a fiduciary. So your obligation is to act in the best interest of of your client. Now, what if somebody says, well, selling them this product and taking $35,000 out of the $500,000 is, I think it's in the best interest of the client. I'm just going to keep what I'm doing. Where's the rub? Where does that come back to haunt the insurance broker here?
Well, you
Could
could
be
have,
sued.
yeah, it moves into the courts, unfortunately, and
So it
that,
allows the brokers to be sued for excessive fees or something. Because I could come in and testify as an economist, look, you're ripping these people off. They could do, in 10 minutes, they could do what you're doing for nothing in terms of fees. They could just go to Treasury Direct, protect themselves against inflation, buy a bond, yields 2.2% real today. The next, it's a long-term bond. And then every year they can take the coupon and buy options all by themselves and at no cost. I mean, that could be me testifying against the insurance agent and in a class action suit against his company. So that's a real concern that they have in the back of their mind about this, that there will be a class action suit going after their fees.
I don't know under what. See, the states regulate insurance, so this is outside of my area of expertise, but the states regulate the insurance, and if it's legal at the state level, how much can be done at the federal level without a change in laws? It's already been through the appeals courts, and but your listeners are this becomes it, when people don't haven't gotten what they wanted at the regulatory level, they go to the courts or to Congress.
I see. So, but there is enough real fear by the insurance industry about this that they've been really up in arms about this pending decision by the Department of Labor to say that insurance brokers are fiduciaries. That's basically this.
That's an awfully weird way, at least for the public, to understand it. And that's like I said before, the EMTs would certainly be horrified at the idea that they are being regulated like doctors, but the individual who's waiting for medical care doesn't care. Whether they're doesn't care what their legal status is, they just want to be helped, and they want to be helped in a way that's not self-serving to the helper. So that's all. It's extremely common sense, and I can't believe that after that we've been arguing for 10 years over whether a financial person should do the right thing by their client. I cannot believe that adults after all these years of watching it and listening to the arguments, I cannot believe that adults are still arguing over. And I think it's a really, really bad look in the long run for the insurance industry to be fighting the responsibility that they have to be honest.
So
That's
you're saying
not.
that you, but you're, so you're also saying here implicitly that for decades the insurance industry has been ripping off the public, their clients in certain products, in the sale of certain products, maybe certain parts of the industry, maybe it's not the entire industry that's been engaging in that kind of practice, but that there is abuse to some degree. Is kind of what you're implying, and you would have better knowledge of this than anybody, I would think.
In other countries, it's just handled completely differently. They're moving to a defined contribution from Social Security, but their defined contribution looks more like our Social Security than it looks like our defined contribution.
Right.
And they don't have all this individual decision making. You don't manage your money before retirement, and you get an annuity in retirement. But we have a free for all, with products and jurisdictions and different kinds of sellers and balkanized regulation, and some people like that. But when the insurance industry doesn't feel like they're being rapacious about this, they feel like it's like we're giving people bread and you want them to eat cake. Well, they can't have cake, and we're giving them bread. And to incentivize a guy to go out, or a salesman to go out there and sell somebody a fixed indexed annuity, they won't do it without this size of commission. So what in the world do you want? I mean, this is how the world works, pal, and get over
Yeah,
it.
I got it. So let me ask you, since you've looked at retirement systems in other countries, if you could, Zach, just wipe away the entire system that we now have, and I'm not talking about Social Security, just the insurance slash mutual fund system, would you replace it with some other countries? And I mean, think about Singapore. They basically forced people for years, and they still do, as far as I know, to contribute to a centralized fund, which is then invested all over the world. And then people get their money back at retirement, but everybody gets the same rate of return. It's not, and I presume the government, since this is being done by the government, the government's not taking any part of that return apart beyond paying for people to actually, keep things straight. Who put in whose money? What was how the market do? How did the fund do this year? Just doing the bookkeeping. Is that a way you would prefer going? Would you like to see us adopt the Singapore system?
You know, there's I met a very wise guy from the London School of Economics named Nicholas Barr, and he believed that, you know, sort of at the end of the day, however you design these retirement systems, it sort of comes out to the same thing, you know, saving in the present to create consumption in the future. And, you know, it's what I've come to the conclusion of is that when these countries that have tried to get rid of their pay-go systems, and you and I might disagree on this, and I'm open to that, but the companies that have tried to go from pay-go to the defined contribution find out that pay-go has a lot fewer moving parts, and that it's really, really hard, as we're finding out with 401k today, to create a defined contribution program plan that delivers with any kind of equity, equitability, and certainty. And it's just, it gets really kind of like for instance, I'll tell you about Australia. Australia has this thing where you know, the employer has to put in 10% or 12% or something like that to the defined contribution plan. And to get employers to do that, though, you can't just wave a wand and say, okay, employers are going to start contributing 10%. No, you have, I mean, it's really complicated. You have to go to the employers or consortium of employers and say, okay, listen, but you're not going to have to give any more raises. It gets really, really complicated that suddenly I think that the Social Security system, for all its problems, and fantastic promises, just has so many fewer. I mean, people who will have nostalgia about Social Security if we go to a defined contribution plan like they have in Australia or Iceland. And
I agree with you, but I do think there's a third way that we could basically freeze the current system and put in a brand new Social Security system for at the margin, which is kind of what corporate America did when they shut down their pe defined benefit plans. I think we could develop a public, no Wall Street involvement Social Security system was fully funded and that was invested with it collectively like they do in Singapore, give everybody the same rate of return, but also have contribution sharing, have the government making progressive contributions on behalf of the poor, the unemployed, the disabled, and then have the money come out in the form of an inflation indexed annuity. I think that could be done overnight and run on my laptop at no cost. And that's what I and other economists have, came up with as a reform plan for Social Security decades ago. There's a book. I'll just make one little pitch here for a book on my website. It's selling for a very good price, zero. And you just go to kotlikoff.net, and it's called You're Hired. It's a free download. You just download it. You read it. There's a section on Social Security. It's got like 10 bullets how to do this. Reform, and it's nothing like Australia's. It's and nothing like the current system, thank God. But it was my platform when I ran for president as a write-in candidate back in 2016. I ran just to write this platform because I thought economists had an obligation to say what we as a group thought we should do to fix Social Security taxes, healthcare, education, everything. And there's not a single PhD in economics in the five of the 535 members of Congress, not a single one. So they nobody knows any economics, so that's why they do so many stupid things, I think. But anyway, one could take a look at that. We're going to certainly have a big debate over the next couple of years over how to address Social Security, and one thing is to kind of do patchwork, operate on some part of the cancer. And I don't use that term lightly, but, and I think Social Security is doing tremendously important thing. I think we absolutely need to have a version of Social Security to protect poor people and disabled people, provide the social insurances that the system has. I really appreciate all the value of the current system. I just think it's been run, financed in a kind of a pay-go manner as a Ponzi scheme, in my view, to the point where it's so broke that we can't maintain it. And it's also very out of date and very sexist in a lot of ways. But I could go on. I don't want to kind of, this is about talking to you, not talking, listening to me. But unfortunately, whenever I get going, I have to stop myself. And that's my problem. But Carrie, do you have any kind of closing? We've had a really interesting conversation. I think you've really educated people a lot on, the annuity industry, that it's not kind of the first thing you learn about an annuity, which is a payment that continues until you die, and that's not the form of a, that's not really what is going on when we're talking about the market for annuities out there. It's the insurance industry, and they're making a pretty good living, and they have a lot of people they have to kind of maybe persuade by driving over to their house and sitting down for them with them for 10 hours of over 10 meetings to get them to buy a product that might presumably may be in their interest, but it is very expensive compared to their doing it themselves if they knew how to do it. But the DOL may be making big changes, and that may be leading to the end of that instrument, that security, or that insurance policy for a lot of people. And that's very interesting. And now you've now kind of educated everybody. This podcast has educated people to look for what's going to happen here in the next few weeks. And then, depending on who's elected for president in November, how that's going to play out in the future, and what the courts are going to do. They're going to, because as soon as something gets issued by the regulation gets issued on this, it will be immediately appealed by the insurance industry to some district court. And then we'll have a legal battle, as we did, as you said, in about 2016, right? So, yeah. So, any closing thoughts? This has been great to have you. I really appreciate it. I learned a lot, let me tell you.
Everything comes down basically to common sense. You really a person who has to take a lot of responsibility for thinking about their own retirement and the thinking about it in advance. And that a lot of it has to do with boring things like making sure your house is paid off and your cars are paid off by the time you think you want to retire, and by delaying Social Security if you can, and working longer, and also understanding a little bit more than you do about about how the financial services works. And I have my own prejudices about that and experiences, you can't just let retirement happen to you in the financial sense. You have to be pretty aggressive about working on
Yeah, well, we agree 100%
it.
on that, and I think we agree probably 90% on everything else. So it's been a real pleasure. I want to thank you so much for coming on. I'm just going to tell this.
I'm very happy to be included among your pantheon of guests.
We've had some really cool guests, and we had people, from all walks of life. We had the poet laureate Robert Pinsky. He's been on twice, and had the former president of Chile, just unfortunately, a very close friend of mine passed away tragically in a helicopter accident about a month ago. Oh,
Oh.
we had some really Martin Wolf, the chief economics correspondent for the Financial Times, all kinds of cool people. And we've also had Carrie Pechter. So that's terrific. Thank you so much again.
Yeah, you're most welcome, and I thank you.
Thank you, Larry. This is great.